All right. So you know, today we will be discussing mainly on class B power amplifiers. So the last session we focused on the principle behind class A power amplifiers. We discussed about series fed class A power amplifier and also transformer coupled class A power amplifier. With respect to operating cycle, we had seen that there is an output swing for the entire 360 degrees of the input swing. So naturally, in terms of efficiency, a class A amplifier is less efficient, right? And we had also seen it seen in the slides that for a series fed class A power amplifier, the maximum efficiency is 25%. So if you want to increase it, then we'll have to go for a transformer coupled class A power amplifier, which will provide us an efficiency of 50%. However, that may not be sufficient, especially with respect to the power applications. So there we will have to move for better class amplifiers. Okay, so the first choice that comes to our mind is class B power amplifiers, because the output swing happens for only 180 degrees of the input cycle. Okay, so that means one transistor will work for only 180 degrees with respect to the input cycle, right? Okay, so because of that, naturally the efficiency will also tend to increase in the case of class B power amplifiers. So today let us just try to discuss one such basic circuit, which is important and is called as a push-pull class B power amplifier. Okay, fine. So before that, the important points are, okay, so let us just highlight on one or two important points with respect to class A as well as class B, right? So class A, with respect to operating cycle, okay, we had seen that the output swing is complete for 360 degrees. And what about the efficiency? The efficiency was 25% if it is a series fed. If it is a transformer coupled, then it is, the maximum efficiency is 50%. So for class B, right, the output swing is 180 degrees. Okay, which means half of the cycle, either the positive half cycle or the negative half cycle. Okay, further, the efficiency will be greater than 50%. How much greater than 50%? We'll just look at it. Okay, fine. And there is one important concept called as push-pull operation with respect to class B power amplifiers. Okay, and there is one major drawback associated with respect to class B amplifiers. So we will also discuss about that, and it is called as crossover distortion. Okay, so what is the solution for minimizing the crossover distortion? We will also be discussing in the next slides. Okay, so let us very quickly go to the circuit. Okay, and then maybe we'll just try to come back to the relevant theory content. Okay, fine. So what does this simple block diagram represent? This represents a push-pull operation that happens in the case of class B power amplifier. So what do we have here? Vi is the input. Okay, one complete cycle, and the first block is one half circuit and the second one is also one half circuit. So what do we have within this one half circuit? Okay, do we have one single transistor, two transistors? Okay, let us just check out those things in our later slides. But if you just compare the output here, okay, the output of one half circuit, you will observe that the positive half of the input is appearing across the output here, right? Whereas for the second half circuit, the negative of the input signal is appearing, right? Okay, so that means there should be something present within this one half circuit that conducts during the positive half cycle and which doesn't conduct, which remains off during the negative half cycle. And finally, what about the load? At the load, finally, okay, we have the combination. If I just consider this to be V1 and let this be V2, so at the load I'll be getting V1 plus V2, okay, both the things, okay, right? So let us just check it out in a lot more detail, right? I'll be going through the circuit first, okay? All right, so that is a typical complementary symmetrical push-pull amplifier circuit. So what do we have here? We have one NPN transistor called as Q1, and the second one, which is a PNP transistor, let us call it as Q2. Okay, fine. And the load is at this particular point, and we are applying a bias VCC for both the transistors, NPN as well as PNP transistor. Now at the input side, okay, if this is VI, then what happens during the positive half cycle of VI? Okay, just observe. During the positive half cycle of VI, let me just write it. During the positive half cycle, this NPN transistor is on, right? So when it is on, due to the applied VCC, a current flows like this across the load. Okay, and some voltage will also appear across the load resistor. But what about the status of Q2? Okay, during the positive half cycle, we are applying a positive voltage to the base of the Q2 transistor. So Q2 transistor is off. Okay, so that means what I'll be getting during the positive half cycle, I'll be getting only the positive half because transistor Q1 is on. Okay, whereas Q2 doesn't affect here because it is biased off by the input cycle. As simple as that. Similarly, during the negative half of VI, the transistor Q1 is off, Q2 is on. Okay, so before that, let me just go back and write it here as Q1 is on and here Q2 is off. Okay, alright. So now during the negative half of VI, Q1 is off and Q2 is on. Okay, so you can very clearly observe that the current is flowing in this direction. Okay, so that means I will be getting the negative half across the load resistor RL, the voltage which appears across the load resistor RL, right? Fine. So ideally, one transistor conducts for half a cycle or 180 degrees of the input cycle, so that at the output side I'll be getting the entire input signal. Okay, because otherwise if I use a single transistor, which was in the case of a class A amplifier, okay, there one transistor was enough. However, here one transistor is not sufficient. I will have to go for two transistors, right? So when I use two transistors, then obviously I must be able to get the entire input signal. Okay, so you know this is what we expect actually.
Excuse me, sir.
Yes.
So some students are trying to join. Can you please accept them?
Okay, just a second. Okay, so to continue further, at the output side, across the load resistor RL, we expect, you know, a nice continuous signal. However, practically it doesn't happen so. What we observe at the output side is a waveform of this kind. Okay, so let me just select. So this is the ideal one. However, the practical waveform which is observed is somewhat of this kind. Okay, wherein you just observe that whenever there is a transition from positive half to the negative cycle, the transition is not smooth. There is some sort of a crossover distortion. What do we mean by crossover? Whenever the signal makes a transition from positive cycle to the negative cycle, the transition should have been smooth. However, it's not smooth, right? And why does this actually happen? This happens because, during the positive half, transistor Q1 conducts, okay? And during the negative half, Q1, which was initially on, should go off. And simultaneously, Q2, which was initially off during the positive half, should immediately switch on during the negative half. However, this doesn't happen. During this course of switching, during this process of switching, each transistor from on to off and from off to on, there is a small momentary delay. I repeat, there is a small momentary delay during which both the transistors are switched off. So just right. So this crossover distortion is due to momentary switching off of both Q1 and Q2 transistors. Now what does that mean? For a small period of time, this axis is time, right? So for a small period of time, exactly here, both the transistors are switched off. One which was actually on is trying to switch off, and the other one which was actually switched off is trying to switch on. Okay, so that means there is no current flow during this particular stage. I repeat, there is no current flowing during this particular crossover distortion phase. Now some of you may ask, sir, what is the problem if there is crossover distortion? So if there is crossover distortion, then the resulting power is the audio. Okay, resulting audio, in the sense we are talking about the output side. See, this RL is nothing but the load, right? Usually this load will be a speaker. Okay, it could be an audio speaker, right? So here there will be audio distortion. Okay, so the audio gets distorted, right? So what do you mean by audio getting distorted? That means the input signal is not properly appearing at the output side. Something else is appearing. It could be noise, or it could be just the blockage of the input signal. Nothing will appear. Okay, so that is very bad as far as high power amplifier design is concerned. It's not good, right? So that is a major drawback, major disadvantage associated with respect to a class B amplifier. Now the question, sir, why are we using this word push pull? Okay, so to explain it in plain terms, what is happening during the positive half cycle? The output is pushed to the VCC value, to the upper value, okay, VCC. So this we call it as push, right? And during the negative half cycle, it is being pulled to the negative value. Okay, so due to which we call it as pull, as simple as that. Okay, right? All right. And complementary, why? Because we are using a pair of NPN as well as PNP transistors. Okay, so it's a complementary pair, one NPN and one PNP. So we call it as complementary symmetry. Symmetry because both of them have the same, you know, device structure. Okay, in the sense, the width parameters of emitter, base, and the collectors of NPN and PNP, they are same. Structurally, they are same. So we use the word symmetry. So it's complementary symmetry push pull amplifier circuit. Okay, so the term, you know, push is associated with respect to the pushing of the output voltage to the highest value, which is VCC, and the pulling is you know, trying to pull the voltage across RL to its lowest value, lowest negative value. Okay, fine. All right, so with that, let us just you know, discuss some of the mathematical expressions. I'll be highlighting only on the main expressions. Okay, you can just refer the textbooks for additional details. Okay, you have a derivation wherein for a class B push pull amplifier, it is being shown that the maximum efficiency is 78.5. okay, so you can just refer that. All right, so how do we define the input DC power? Input DC power for this particular circuit is defined as VLRMS, where VLRMS is the RMS voltage across the load resistor. Okay, so it's V square RMS upon RL. Similarly, output AC power is V square L peak to peak divided by 8 RL. Okay, I had you know, just given you a task to check out why do you get the factor of 8, right, when we were talking about the efficiency of class A amplifiers. So I suggest students to again go through that thing. Why do you get this particular factor? Alright, so if you try to convert that just in terms of the peak value, then it will be V square divided by 2 RL. Efficiency. The efficiency is again being given by the expression output AC power by input DC power. So if you just substitute, simplify the expressions, then you will arrive at the term 78.5, okay, percentage, which is the maximum efficiency of a class B push pull power amplifier. Power amplifier. Okay. Now, if you want the efficiency slightly better, then you'll have to go for other power amplifiers like class D amplifiers. Okay. All right. So, yes, I think there was one more important point to be mentioned here, and that is regarding the crossover distortion. Now, how do we eliminate this crossover distortion? If we use a class B power amplifier, then in most of the cases, this crossover distortion will happen. It will occur. Okay. The most feasible and the simplest solution is to ensure that before the transistor Q2 switches off, I repeat, before the transistor Q2 switches off, there is a constant flow of current in the transistor Q1, and you know, vice versa. So that means at any point of time, there is always some amount of current flowing through the circuit. If we ensure this particular condition, then we can eliminate crossover distortion. And this particular condition is being met in the case of class AB power amplifiers. Okay, alright, so this is just the detailed transformer based coupled push pull circuit, right? We usually call this as pre amplifier stage, and this stage is usually it's called as, you know, push pull amplification. Okay, so you can very clearly observe that the output across the load is nothing but a speaker. Okay, in simple terms, okay, what is happening here? For example, see, class B amplifiers are usually used in audio amplifiers, especially at the output speaker stage, right? Wherein, you know, for example, at the speaker end, we usually need a very powerful amplification, right? Okay, because a small music signal, okay, which is a very small one at the input side, must be amplified, right? Its power must be enhanced, so it should be a high power one, high power sound. So this high power sound can be produced by using a push-pull amplifier. Okay, so this push-pull amplifier ensures that, and I'll just try to, you know, highlight this particular transducer speaker, you know, phenomena which usually happens. If you consider, you know, this to be series of transducers, okay, and you know they'll be continuously vibrating up and down. Okay, so this up stage you can call it as, you know, push stage, and the down stage, okay, pull stage. And you know these are all very minute mechanical vibrations, but the end result with respect to electrical parameters is very huge. Okay, so the audio signal is greatly amplified here if we are using a push-pull amplifier. However, if there is crossover distortion, then you may have noticed that, you know, suddenly a jerky sound may appear, or the sound may, you know, suddenly disappear, especially in the case of a speakers. So that is due to crossover distortion, right? All right, so to talk more about amplifier distortion, any signal varying over less than the full 360 degree cycle is considered to have a distortion. So what does that mean? That means class A amplifiers are not supposed to have any distortion, whereas other amplifiers, they are supposed to have the distortion, because the signal, they obviously vary lesser than full 360 degrees, right? However, in terms of efficiency, we prefer class B or maybe class AB or in fact class D amplifiers, because they are all digitized signals. So there is a trade-off now between operating cycle and the efficiency. Okay, so that is one point. So the design circuit engineers must carefully select a particular amplifier based on the application. Further, the distortion can also occur because the device characteristics is not linear. Yes, in which case non-linear or amplitude distortion may occur. Next, the circuit elements and the devices may respond to the input signal differently at various frequency. Quite true. Okay, for example, you know, there may be some resistors, capacitors and all, they will be responding in a different way for different frequencies. This will result in frequency distortion. Okay, I assume that you may have studied something about the distortion, especially the signal you know, the signal distortion in your Fourier analysis. Okay, I'm not aware whether you have come across this thing or not, but just to keep that in your mind, just remember that distortion can be described mathematically using Fourier analysis. We'll not be going into the details of it, how and why, okay, other things and all. It's beyond the scope of your syllabus, but just keep it in your mind. Okay, fine. Then it's a method that describes any periodic waveform in terms of its fundamental frequency component and the frequency components at integer multiples. So these are called as harmonic components or harmonics. What do we mean by this? Okay, let us just explain, try to understand it in very simple terms. Okay, let me assume that it's a power amplifier, irrespective of whether it is A, B or AB, whatever, right? It's a power amplifier. okay, and at the input side I have a signal whose fundamental frequency is 1 kilohertz. Okay, let me just assume. At the output side, due to distortion, okay, I may get this 1 kilohertz frequency, no doubt, but additionally I may also get the or some other frequency components which are the integer multiples of this base or the fundamental frequency 1 kilohertz. Now what do you mean by integer multiples? Integer multiples in the sense, you know, the next frequency components could be like this. Now you know this could be 2 kilohertz. This could be 3 kilohertz. Okay, just an example I'm talking about. Okay. Don't go with the shape of the waveforms and all. This again could be 2 kilohertz. So now, and this could be 3 kilohertz. So 2 kilohertz and 3 kilohertz, they are integer multiples of the base or fundamental frequency 1 kilohertz. And these are being produced. They appear. Okay. And it is very important for us to control them. Right? Because for our main application, they may not be useful. So these are called harmonics. Okay? In musical instruments, electrical musical instruments, there may be a case wherein harmonics are purposely introduced. Hope students can understand. Okay? Whereas in some other electrical instruments, these harmonics may be called as noise. Okay? They may not, they may not be required. Unwanted things. Right? So these harmonics play a very crucial role, very important role in amplification stage. Okay? So the same is being explained here. If 1 kilohertz is a fundamental frequency, then the integer multiples will be called as harmonics. Okay? Fine. So Fourier analysis does not allow for fractional harmonic frequencies, only integer multiples of the fundamental. So that's your the condition in your Fourier analysis. Okay, the fractional frequencies will not be allowed. Okay, fine. All right. So to continue further about harmonic distortion, you have a simple formula to calculate the nth harmonic distortion, like second, third, fourth, fifth. So in that way, how do we calculate the nth harmonic distortion and what is its effect on the total harmonic distortion, right? So that's the formula being given. So dn is nth harmonic distortion expressed in terms of percentage. So it is nothing but the ratio of the nth harmonic wave by the fundamental amplitude. Okay, hope you can understand. So this is amplitude of nth harmonic and this is amplitude of the fundamental frequency. Okay, fine. So the fundamental component is typically larger than any harmonic component. A very, very important point. Okay. So how do you calculate the total harmonic distortion? Well, the total harmonic distortion, say for example, you know, if this is the fundamental one, these are all harmonics, assume. Okay, so the total harmonic distortion, you will have to consider both the sides, all these things. Okay, so the THD stands for total harmonic distortion, is given by the square root of the summation of squares of the second, third, fourth, like this till nth harmonic distortion. Okay, so just to go with the an example, it's a textbook solved example, so I have taken the same thing here. Calculate the harmonic distortion components for an output signal having the fundamental amplitude of 2.5 volts. So here the fundamental amplitude is of 2.5 volts. The second harmonic amplitude is of 0.25. Okay, which is much lesser when compared to the fundamental amplitude. Similarly, third harmonic amplitude is still lesser, 0.1. Fourth one, a lot lesser. Right? Now we'll have to find out the individual distortion and then the total harmonic distortion due to these three second, third and fourth harmonic amplitudes, right? So how do you calculate the second harmonic distortion? Using this particular expression A2 by A1. So it is being shown that it is 10%. Similarly, D3, A3 by A1, 4%. D4, A4 by A1, which is 2%. So you can very clearly observe that the distortion in terms of percentage is getting on reducing, right? So what about the collective one? The total harmonic distortion, if you take the square root, then it will come around 10.95%. Okay, so what conclusion can we make based upon this value? We can say that the second harmonic amplitude is very bad for the fundamental amplitude, okay, right? Because its amplitude is very next to the fundamental amplitude, so its effect is also larger when compared to the other higher order harmonics. Okay, fine. So that was all about class B amplifiers. Now very quickly we'll just go through one or two points regarding class AB amplifiers. Okay, in your syllabus we have framed the contents in such a way that we are focusing mainly on class A and class B amplifier. Okay, and we will just be touching upon class AB, class C and class D amplifiers. Right, so to talk about class AB amplifiers eliminate the crossover distortion problem, as I had already mentioned, which happens in the case of class B amplifiers. Then, unlike class B amplifiers, class AB amplifiers, the current always flows through any one of the transistors. A very, very important point. Okay, then, before the current stops flowing through one transistor, it starts flowing through the second one. Okay, hope you can correlate these sentences to the circuit which we had seen previously. Okay, so for this particular circuit, right? All right. Okay, so moving forward towards class C amplifier. We have already studied about class C amplifiers in our previous chapters, and we know that class C amplifiers, they use a combination of L and C called as tank circuit. Tank circuits are mainly used in resonant circuits, wherein the property of resonance is being extracted. Okay, so if we use a power amplifier along with a tank circuit, a combination of L and C, that particular thing is called as class C amplifier. Since we extract the tuning property, then we can say that a class C amplifier is biased to operate for lesser than 180 degrees of the input signal cycle. The tuned circuit in the output, however, will provide a full cycle of the output signal. A very important point, because here we are concentrating on the peak resonance. Okay, other things we are ignoring. We are only focusing on the resonance part. Okay, and this resonance is provided by the tank circuit LC. So either you can use a normal amplifier or a power amplifier. Okay, if the resonance is to be achieved such that the amplitude of the resonance peak is extremely high, then instead of a normal amplifier we'll go for a power amplifier. Okay, fine. Then class D amplifiers. Well, class D amplifier is designed to operate with digital or pulse type signals. Please focus on the word digital. So since they use pulse type signals, its efficiency is well over or greater than 90%. And this higher efficiency makes it a very attractive device to be used in power amplifiers. So nowadays, most of the analog circuits, high power analog circuits, are being replaced by high power digital circuits because of their efficiency. So just to talk about these waveforms, right? So here we have input signal. The blue color waveform is the input, and we also have a sawtooth waveform which acts as a chopping waveform. Chopping in the sense we are trying to cut. Okay, see, in reality a signal cannot be cut, but chopping in the sense we are trying to interfere, okay, the frequency points, right? So just observe what happens at the output side. At the output side, wherever the sawtooth waveform, okay, cuts the input waveform, that particular thing we extract. Okay, so this thing. So what do I get here? I should be getting a waveform of this kind, right? Actually, okay. However, these edges are again smoothened. I repeat, these edges are smoothened so that I'll be getting a digitized pulse, which is being given here. Okay. So the same thing occurs here. So this is all done by considering the edges. Okay. So that's the digital waveform which is produced as the output in the case of class D amplifiers. Okay, so it is being written that chopping of a sinusoidal waveform to produce a digital waveform. Okay, so the corresponding circuit can also be seen here, the block diagram of a class D amplifier. So what all things are present? The original input signal, right? And then you have a sawtooth generator which produces a sawtooth waveform. Then both the things are given as input to a comparator. What does a comparator do? Well, you will be studying about these things once you take up the course on linear integrated circuits. Okay, and I also assume that you must have studied something about a comparator in your digital circuits also. What does a comparator do? It just compares the voltage levels of the input signals, okay, two input signals which are fed, and then tries to make a decision. Okay, so you have a comparator here, and then the output of a comparator is being fed to the amplifier, and then finally it is fed to a low pass filter. Okay, what is the usage of a low pass filter? The low pass filter ensures that the lower frequency signals are passed, okay, whereas the higher frequencies are just blocked. Okay, only the low frequency signals are allowed to pass. Okay, so then, that's the process which usually happens in the case of class D amplifiers, wherein the main objective is to produce digitized pulses. Okay, fine. So I think we will stop with this. Fine. All right, so to summarize, what did we do today? We discussed some important aspects about class B amplifiers. Okay, so in terms of efficiency, they are slightly better when compared to class A, because every transistor or each transistor in a push-pull amplifier circuit operates for 180 degrees. Fine. And a problem that occurs in the case of class B amplifier is called as crossover distortion. So this crossover distortion problem can be eliminated by replacing a class B with a class AB amplifier. Okay, and we also discussed about the concept of harmonics, the fundamental frequency and the harmonic components. Okay. So the associated, the mathematical expression to find out the total harmonic distortion, and then some simple things about class AB, class C and class D. All right. Okay, so I think we will stop here.